So let's welcome Graham Kent.
Thanks for coming out on a snowy night. I drove over the top. I'm like, oh, another year like this. Great. So anyway, this is going to be a little bit of a travelogue style talk of playing with the LiDAR data set this summer. And we're looking at really a narrow slice of what can be done with LiDAR. So we're looking more at the fault application. And there are people that are going to be looking at runoff and canopy density, and we're not going to talk about that. We're talking about faults. And this is building on a lot of work that we've done over the last 12 years. Started when I was at Scripps. And obviously Tahoe's a really neat place. But we'll talk about faults, some landslides, and other landforms with lasers. And we'll talk about a few other things. But before we do that, we'll...
Let's get ready to rumble!
All right, everyone wake up. Hey, one of the things, just to highlight, to thank again Heather, who's a one-person wrecking crew up here, if you know her. We were able to put a NetQuakes instrument. What's a NetQuakes instrument? Into the basement here, right below us. So let's everyone jump up and down. Anyway, it's a low-cost seismometer. I think I'm kind of, is it too loud?
No.
Okay, all right, cut that. No. It's a low-cost seismometer, about $4,000. It hooks into Wi-Fi. And it doesn't stream continuously, but when there's an earthquake like this little guy right here a couple days ago, up above Mount Rose right there, we get location, another piece of data in time to help us better locate earthquakes. And so we're going to add these about 20 more throughout the northern part of the state, and we'll help build our network in a way that isn't so expensive. But anyway, thanks a lot for having that. And you can go to NetQuakes, type in Google, and quickly you'll see the Nevada button, and then you can click the little star right there or the little plus sign right at Incline. You can see the latest earthquake. We have earthquakes here, right? Okay, good. So occasionally you'll get to see an earthquake. One of the things that I'd like to talk about a little bit, just to give you a little background on how things have changed and how science is kind of always dynamic. So we just don't always know everything. We actually learn things through time, which is good. There was kind of a real large change in how we viewed our neck of the woods about a decade ago. And people back in Lone Pine a little over 135 years ago found out the hard way. So they found out the real deal. This is a map here that's a little bit, I'm just going to belt it. How about that? It might be easier.
Double check.
Sorry about that. I'll just keep it on. Okay, so anyway, everyone can hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I still have a voice. Hey, so anyway, this is not your typical map with north being straight up, but it is basically in the reference frame of what's known now as the Sierra Nevada Great Valley Microplate.
Did you change the station?
Maybe that's what I did.
Here's what we did real quick. There you go.
Okay, so anyway, now we got through that little technical difficulty. It's time for an earthquake. So this is a little bit different orientation that you might be used to, but it's really in the reference frame of these things called microplates. And this happens to be the Sierra Nevada microplate. And that's kind of what I call plate tectonics 2.0. Because usually when your kids go to sixth grade or you read in National Geographic, there's these plates, and there's the San Andreas on one side is the Pacific, and the other side is North America, and that's just it. But these plate boundaries are much more diffuse. And in some cases, you get these things which are very common in the oceanic realm, and more surprising to some degree in this setting, but they're called microplates. So these are like little plates within plates, and they don't deform too much. And this guy here is kind of cruising to the north,
in this, really the northwest, but straight up and down. And it really lets you allows you to look at this whole area, which we used to call the basin and range, in a different perspective. Most of you live in the Sierra Nevada, you want to know why do we have the mountain range there, for example. Well, that'd be interesting. And this is actually related to this process. In fact, what's going on here today is very similar to what happened down in the Baja California Peninsula starting about 12 million years ago. And the kind of typical basin and range as you drive across 50 and you go through the basin and ranges, that is not a dead structure, but there's not a lot of extension here anymore. It's something that had a lot more action tens of millions of years ago. Most of the plate movement is in this Walker Lane feature. And it's both extensional and translational. So what does that mean? Think of it this way. This is oversimplified to a degree, but not too much. If you want to divide up the plate boundary across North America and Pacific, you'd put 25% to the east of to the west of the San Andreas, 50% on San Andreas, 25% to the east. That's just a rough, changes with latitude, but just a rough give and take. So about a quarter of the plate motion is to the east of the San Andreas. Well, I think a lot of us 20 years ago, we have a couple of geologists in the crowd, we used to just want to take that 25% and divide it across and, you know, kind of go out to Snowbird. So, you know, Snowbird to Homewood, put it in there. But what we're finding out now is most of that 25% is hooked in this Walker Lane. And again, there's this extensional component, translational. The extensional component is in large part responsible for the Sierra Nevadas. So we are your typical rift basin. We just don't have Baja California and the waters coming into it yet. So what does that mean for you in terms of earthquake hazards and just why Tahoe's here? Think of it this way. That half of the San Andreas motion, not all of the plate, but half of the San Andreas motion is just in your backyard. It's not spread across the entire basin range. It's in your backyard. And these several basins be big. Okay? So that's kind of interesting. Like, wow, we have a lot focused here just to the east of the Sierra, which is not a surprise. And just to show you how large some of these earthquakes have gotten, this is this kind of nebulous, because it's old, 7.6 to 8.0 event in Lone Pine. So we can have big earthquakes in the Walker Lane. Okay, so that's a little bit of plate tectonics 2.0. What I thought I'd do is just give you a little background on the work that we've been doing. And for many years, again, a little bit of an exaggeration, but we spend most of our time in water. And the reason why we do that is that we've developed various tools, sonar equipment, that allow us to do things much more easily than you could ever do on land. So if the Lord floodeth, then we have a whole new set of tools. Unfortunately, we can't just flood and then unflood. So, you know, when you have water, you use the tools you have. When you have no water, you just have barren earth, you use a different set of tools. And this is just an example of really the first profile we ever cut across the state line, followed by right here. And this is what we'll see a little bit later, is this bathymetric map done by the USGS back in 98. Revealed a lot of things, including some fault scarps that we decided to go out and image with our church sonar. Folks at Scripps, and when I was at Scripps at the time, and Neil Driscoll in particular. And this is an example of the top of the McKinney Bay slide, and it's offset 21 meters. So just think of it as a road cut. And right, everything's like a layered cake you buy at Rayleigh's. Maybe tastes a little better. And as you basically fault, the layers get separated. And then there's more frosting on the downdrop side. And so there's a little thicker amount of frosting on this side than that side. But again, we can easily go out and measure these basic features and how much they're offset. What we've learned, go ahead.
Are you saying you cut the cake and you drop
it? Exactly, yeah. Okay. Yep, the left side of the cake goes down onto the floor. And one of the things that we've just been published in Nature about a month ago was kind of an out, you know, things exported, this is the first place we did it, but about these triggering episodes of flooding in the Salton Sea and those faults that were triggered by the floods then triggered the San Andreas, and we're using the same technology we developed in Tahoe, we're able to go back 14 earthquakes. So we can go back in time and see the 14 separate earthquakes, like you would do in a trench, if it was on land, but we can now do it in the water. So we're really developing new technologies. And between these little slices through the lake and the bathymetry itself, and of course we'll talk about the land part, the Tahoe Basin is a pretty simple robin, as we call it, asymmetric half robin, but it's really one fault system, plus or minus, and it has a bunch of left steps and right steps, the other one. And so you have the West Tahoe Fault coming in here, ultimately dying out as a dollar point. So a lot of the strain is, or movement, is onto the State Line Fault, and then it steps over to the Incline Village Fault and up to Mount Rosigo. All right? And again, I want you to also remember these blocks, because this is the McKinney-Bay slide. And when these things got shot out, it was kind of a different world. And Stephen McQuinn did some really neat visualization. I'll show you in a minute. But so that's kind of what we've been doing, taking full advantage of living in the water. Okay? So that's been kind of fun. And I won't talk about that too much today, because we're talking about LiDAR. But one of the things, to give you some idea of why it's important, even if I know everything exactly correct in the water and understand how those faults rupture in the water, it would still be very useful to know what the landward components do, because the longer the faults rupture, the more you'll tend to see higher displacements in the water, and those would lead towards tsunamis. Like, for example, here is this Phuket, and this thing rolled in somewhere between about 6 and 10 meters, and so as we'll find out, those are the types of tsunami wave heights that you can see from just garden variety earthquakes in Lake Tahoe. And we all know about Tahoe, all right? And this was very interesting because we now know that the actual plates, as one subducting underneath the other, actually slipped 50 meters.
50?
50. Five first downs. As a Charger fan, I usually don't get five first downs in a game. Well, somehow they're 3-1 and they're not that good. Right? Can you imagine 50 meters? Oh my God. And so, obviously, there's a lot of complications to the ruptures we won't talk about right now, but, you know, it put in about 14 to 18 meters worth of wave heights, and where areas were constricted, those waves went up as high as 60, 70 meters. I mean, there's a 12-story building with a car on top, all right? This is kind of fun because it's such a cool visualization, but this is a calculation by Stephen Ward and then Steve Quinn.
And these are these kind of black swan scenarios. So I was at a recent Southern California Earthquake Center meeting, and we were told to start to engage these kind of scenarios that aren't super, super likely, but might be likely. And so we're going to now look at what happens to Lake Tahoe if we lose some of the size. And again, this is not from an earthquake. Could be earthquake triggered. The wave heights go up to about 400 feet. And having grown up in the South Shore, actually, if you watch the wave now, the airport runway wasn't there at the time. But the waves certainly take advantage of it now. It starts running. The only point I would make here is that the likelihood of another McKinney-Bay slide is probably pretty small. That doesn't mean that you don't have a spectrum between nothing and something. Okay? You could, in principle, have even a small little sliver go with an earthquake and turn your 5-meter or 10-meter tsunami into a 30-meter or 20-meter. And so that's some of the things that we also might be able to learn by looking at the LiDAR. How prominent are landslides around the basin? We know this, there was this big can of whoop ass, quite frankly, you know, what we think about 50,000 years ago, but, you know, what do we know about potential other slides? LiDAR data addresses that to some degree.
So you basically have no warning. In 10 minutes, the entire basin would be destroyed.
In either case, in one case, it's kind of, you know, it's like hitting a hole in one. Great. But you know, the more likely scenario is a 3 to 10 meter tsunami wave, and And that if people move off the beach, they're going to be in a lot better situation. Again, remember, the wavelength of displacement isn't 70 or 80 kilometers like it is in these subduction zones. So the run-up won't be the same, but right on the beach, it's not going to be a pretty day. All right, so we're going to talk about LiDAR here, right? So LiDAR stands for Light Detection and Ranging. It's using lasers. And I was involved with TRPA. And then this, you know, having grown up here, everyone picks the TRPA. So when they do something right, you got to let them know. And they did something fantastic here. It's a data set that will be extremely useful for decades and decades. Of course, we were begging for this, you know, 10 years ago when it wasn't $300,000, it was like $6 million. But whenever I think of lasers, because it's kind of, it's supposed to be a fun talk, right, you know, and how we used to beg for this LiDAR data set, I can only think of one person who can be a better spokesman than I.
Request. And that is to have sharks with freaking laser beam that goes to their heads. Now, evidently, my cycloptic colleague informs me that that can't be done.
So that was pretty much us ranting. So we wanted freaking LiDAR in the Tahoe Basin. They just look at us like, yeah, $6 million, it's not going to happen to us. But it finally did. And you're going to look at LiDAR data that doesn't look like what we see in the lower left-hand corner. And at any rate, if we all come up in single file line, look carefully. No. But it's kind of a bare earth model with point clouds showing the trees. And if you look at it in its full glory, I mean, it looks like you were hovering above it in a helicopter. You can see the trees, you can see the ground, and it looks like you're there. And again, the resolution is sub-meter, although I think to be true, it's probably meter resolution in terms of pixel size. Here's a map showing where they collected it, and different amounts of hits that hit the ground, because we asked the contractor to have 12 hits per square meter, and in some places, 8 or 9 of them came back and basically showed you the canopy, okay? So, anyway, we decided not to go to the half meter, which was spec'd out, and we just kind of averaged everything to meter pixel. And, how's it going? Didn't know you were a Texas fan. We might have to close the doors. Anyhow, we're going to go through a little tour of the area. And we're going to start with the West Tahoe Fault. Let's see. So here's some of the peculiarities of this. And I know Rich will enjoy this one as well, since he's walked through this area. So here's the West Tahoe Fault. This is certainly the largest fault in the Tahoe Basin through here, right? It probably has the potential of about 7.2, 7.3. We believe the last rupture was 4,100 to 4,500 years ago. We see a rupture at 8,000 years ago and around 11,000 to 12,000. If you do the math, it's about a 4,000 year recurrence interval. The last one was about 4,100 to 4,500 years ago. This is in contrast, you can all relax. The Incline Village that goes probably every 15 or 20,000 years was 500 years ago. Doesn't mean it can't happen tomorrow, but if you were a betting person, you'd head on to West Tahoe Fault. So we're going to start with that one first. And what I can't describe to you, unless we all go out there, is Lake Tahoe's a very challenging place because you have trees and tourists and pine needles and everything else. And what you can do with the LiDAR is you can create something called bare earth model. So what you do is you just buzz saw every tree in the basin. That's not good. You knock down every house in the basin. That might be good. And what you have left is called the bare earth. And so from a standpoint of a geologist or geophysicist, this is what we like. Just remove everything in the way, make it look like it's in the desert, and we're done. So this is the first kind of piece that, which was interesting, is back in a paper a few years back, we had basically caught wind of this slice right here. And having grown up and jumped off the cliffs at Angora, I knew about this slice already. In fact, this piece separates the lower and upper Angora parking lot. So if you want to know why there's two parking lots, thank you, West Tahoe. Okay. And then what we did because this is a, if you've ever hiked here, it's a royal pain in the butt, is we just dashed it in from here to here. We didn't know where it was. So this is the one area that we're really curious, because we couldn't find, you know, here it's so prominent. As we'll see, this is a shaded topographic map, and here is the fault. Everyone see that?
Mm-hmm.
Coming in here, dies, steps over. Okay. So this was the first thing I got to see. Well, actually, that's not true. I was working with the QC with the data, with Watershed Sciences, and I'd get little snippets, but it didn't look like I'm used to looking at, and this is what I'm used to looking at LiDAR data. And so when I saw that, I was just like, wow, that's so cool. And lo and behold, here's the stuff that we missed. And if you try to walk this, it's just, oh my God. I took these four kids from North Carolina Central University. It's a predominantly African-American university out in the Carolinas. And you know, we had to buy them boots because they've never hiked before. And these poor kids went up to what I call Earthquake Lake here, and I'm like dying, you know? And they're just like, what are you, you know, they thought it was actually pretty fun. But the fault actually cruises across, here's Highway 50, and you know where they shoot the blob, the shells up onto the slopes, and the avalanches come down? Then right here, across the road. So one thing we know, whenever it ruptures, Highway 50 is going to be closed for a while. Someone's going to get a heck of a jump, though, you know? Maybe that girl in that Civic commercial.
The fault comes right through there at Gunmount Curve. That's where it comes across.
Yeah, right. So you can see the road. See, everybody see the road? That sweeping turn. That's right there. And that's right there. And they're about ready to get hit. And so, yeah, it's right, really right there. When you're out there, here's the problem. You can go almost anywhere in the Tahoe Basin and see a slope that looks like that. It's just like, oh, there's a slope. You know, whatever. What's amazing, though, is all those whatevers, when you look at the bare earth, kind of all average out and your eye doesn't catch it. If there's any continuity to it, and again, you can't see for a hill of beans down the, you know, if you're in the desert, you might be able to like spitball it and look at it for like a mile or look down it. But, you know, you just pop out the LiDAR, it's cheap. I mean, it really is cheap. I mean, this is the technology, the power of technology. And so, you know, we pretty much learned right away. Now, that was kind of an interesting thing.
So, are you going to answer why there's that discontinuity there in the vault, like the vault and then it's shifted over?
Vaults have this weird thing. They tend to be a little more continuous at depth. And as they kind of get up in the lower stress areas, they tend to have the offsets. And sometimes the offsets are so large that they're not connected at depth. And the closer they are, these little steps, the earthquake can rupture through it. And if they're too far apart, then they can't. The longer the rupture is, the greater the earthquake potential is. Although, as we found out in the Sierras, in this area, you can have very short faults, have very large earthquakes. Now, go ahead.
What is the lake you're calling Earthquake Lake?
It is, you get to always name something, right, somewhere in your
yes.
life. And we said, well, what's this lake? It's really a meadow. But this year it was a lake. Here's Angora Lake, uh-huh. upper. Here's the cliffs that I jumped off. I know the Hildingers, they're still mad at me because we're some of the first kids that did it way back in the day. Now that's all they do is carry people out of there. so just one little kind of spur, kind of quasi-moraine will jump over, it's right there. And the fire that started over there, the Angora Ridge fire, is kind of ignited somewhere in this area. And what's really neat is you look at this in this application called Pleader Maps, you're like, oh, that's really easy. I'll just walk up that hill. But you know, the hill's 35, 40 degrees, and you're slipping, and your students are looking at you. But I really like this place because at some point we have to figure out how to do a more conventional, what we call paleoseismic trench, and basically trench in this meadow, because we can actually see in the LiDAR, it was dry, we can still see the fault scarp in the actual quote unquote kind of meadow itself. And so this piece here has likely dropped about 12 meters relative to that piece since the Ice Age. And yet you look at it, it's all flat. So there's going to be this perfect sedimentary record of rupture for this segment in Earthquake Lake. So I was out with quartzite geologist the second time I was up there. We went It's much easier if you ever want to go up here to go from Angola, not this way. And I just, so there's LiDAR, right? So I tried something called NIDAR. So I was going to see if I could walk across the lake, and as I went from the down drop to the up drop, it should get shallower. So why didn't it work? I just sank through. I was like, at some point I'm going, this is the stupidest idea in the world. But I thought it might work. But again, every 5 or 10 kilometers that we add to the west Tahoe fall, obviously that's the potential of having a bigger and bigger earthquake with the maximum offset underneath the lake, and that's the thing that's going to generate a larger tsunami if that scenario is true. And here's Tulu, and she's coming up this bloody slope that's really steep right up this little chute right here. And and Gretchen Schmauder is the student working on this, and we had an interesting summer, to say the least. And we're not sure, but she may have fractured her leg on one of these forays and then further broke it running, but it doesn't mean it's easy to get to. This scarp behind the lemonade stand at Angora, so now you know how to find it, is beautiful. And again, this is kind of, growing up as a kid and having walked by her 1,000 times, I was, even when I was a geology major, I could figure this one out, but I was too much wanting to just go up there and jump off the thing, and yet this is one of the most beautiful scarps in the basin, and yet I was kind of completely blind to it, saw the LiDAR, I probably should have a little more curiosity. And this is, again, another good point where this fault's coming in here and dying and stepping over here, and that's actually a pretty big step. It's not a kilometer, but it's a big step in the fault. And in some sense might inhibit rupture from one step to another. Time will tell. But again, if you're ever, this is literally 100 yards back of the lemonade stand. If you want to see that scarp. And you can actually see where this kind of has what looks to be potentially 3-event scarp. So you can kind of see where it ruptured several times in it. And we'll talk about that later.
Where does the offset take place? Once you leave Angora, it offsets over? Where is that?
Like right when you're right at Lower Angora Lake, and right before you start heading up the hill, uh-huh. You kind of cruise through a couple trees. This is how many times I've been there. Right, there's some bark that looks down. And what you do there is just beeline it to the left. And it's really full of trees, and then you kind of come out another 150 feet, and it's like, wow, that's pretty cool.
I mean, that's not the offset you're speaking of where it jumps.
Yeah, so it's there down to the parking lot.
Okay.
So it's really the west side of Angora Lakes to the parking lot. And you will see bigger ones in the lake, so it's not like, wow, it's unusual, but that is a step that can confuse you, at least if you're me. So I'd be remiss to say that there's LiDAR, which is kind of cool because it's in the land, and it's meter pixel resolution with several centimeters, but lo and behold, we can do the same thing in the water now. So you look at the old Tahoe map, that's like 10 meter pixel, several meters vertical resolution. We can now go in there and do several centimeter resolution and meter pixel. And what do you think these two systems have in common? One shoots lasers, one shoots sonar. The most important and common thing that makes these things expensive is the inertial guidance. So if you're sitting in Fall Leaf Lake and some jerk comes by you on a wakeboard, the next thing I'll do the same thing. But all of a sudden, the sonar head that's in the water all of a sudden deviates like this. So now your beams are painting 25, 30 meters over to the side relative to where they should be. Right? If I'm in an airplane and I hit a little turbulence, the airplane jerks, and now that laser shoots out. So you really need that kind of rocket guidance. And so this is why this system here costs about $500,000. And one of my students, Annie, she's gonna raise her hand back there. We played a game on her because one of these little boxes,
$100,000.
And we're like, Annie, here. You need to open this and screw this in and don't drop it. And you can immediately say, $100,000, don't worry, it's only $10,000 to open the box if anything goes wrong. But again, this is what we need to do to not only educate the next generation, but also to make just spectacular maps of the bottom of lakes like Lake Tahoe. And this is the first time anyone saw the bottom of all those lakes. There's a bottom. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the West Tahoe Fault cruises through here, down right there. And then there's some complicated, I know geology is complicated. Looks like a split comes up here, and then one comes down here, and so it gets a little bit ugly. In the lake itself, we can see two splays of the West Tahoe Fault. Again, think of your layer cake, and they should be flat. And in fact, you see these two little things that have tweaked the sediments. And there's a little weird little wedge there. That's a landslide or a turbidite slide that filled in that space, and that's how we get the date from the last earthquake.
Are you getting those also via sound waves?
So yeah, all this stuff is sound waves. So, but again, when you understand how to do LiDAR and then you airborne and you learn how to do sonar, the biggest problem is the commonality of this, knowing where your laser beam or your sonar head is. And again, this is some of our students, and there's Amy on top and Annie and alone.
Is north up on that last picture, the picture of the lake?
North would be or below.
That's Falling Leaf Lake.
That's Falling Leaf Lake, and this is where the West Tahoe Fault comes in and pretty much goes by the where they wash off from invasive species, that little hut there, that little building.
The marina?
The marina is just a little bit on the other side. So, Talax right up here, and you'll see if you get a better sense of it on the next plot.
Okay.
And then Baldwin Beach will be here.
Yeah.
Cool thing I should show is all these kind of recessional morainal features that you see in these data. So if you're a glaciologist, holy smokes, this stuff looks great. I mean, you can see things that you knew were there, but just when you finally see it with everything stripped off, it's a wholly different experience, at least for me. Okay, so one of the pieces of the system comes out of here, goes, anyone been to Cathedral Lake?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just pick a lake, hit the west side, there's a fault. So, Cathedral. And it comes through here, and now it's rupturing through kind of some older rocky material here. So a lot of the other stuff is at least 10,000 years or younger. This stuff's a little bit older. And in fact, you can see it cruise right down into Cascade Lake. And here's Gretchen again. This is not the main scarp. This is one of the ancillary scarps. This area here by Cathedral Lake is, this beautiful scarp was just full of bugs and mosquitoes. There's no way that we would have spent a minute there looking for it if you wouldn't be able to see it from air photos. You would have died from blood loss if you spent any time looking for it. But all you do is just program in your GPS, and I bring up this laptop, and we'd just be up there doing this cool stuff. Again, so we're now going to look kind of towards the, so it's dropping, so here's the West Tahoe. Again, there's some weirdness in here. It looks like there's a scarp here to about there, and then there's something over here, and again, geology isn't always pretty, but I think the main thing is probably tracking along here. And we see some of it off Baldwin Beach as well in the sonar data up here. So this is a very complicated area, but certainly a chunk of it comes off here. You can see it right on this moraine coming down here. There's like a little bit of a landslide. A little bit of a landslide right there in the corner of the lake comes in. And what we did this summer was we brought up a boat that was a little more transportable and went and talked to the owners of Cascade Lake, because they own the whole lake, and they're very cool about it. And so we got the boat barely into Cascade. And literally there's a boat ramp, and we had this much on either side of the tire, and it took Rob like an hour to back it up through the trees and stuff. We certainly see some features that are, you know, giving us a sense of faulting here. Although I think most of the sediment that's infilling has occurred after the space has been made. So if I had to guess right now, is that this sediment here is all pretty recent. But by the time we get into Fallen Leaf Lake, I mean, to Emerald Bay, it's pretty much lost its punch. I had to guess, and I know I think Jim's been doing some work here on the LiDAR, if I had to guess, the island would be on the footwall, not the side that drops down. But there's just, we have church day in there, there just isn't a lot of offset, but I think that's the natural grain of where it dies into Elm Bay, like literally right at the island. Now, we're going to play a little bit of water time again. So unfortunately, or fortunately, big chunks of the West Tahoe Fault here are 400+ meters in the water. Believe it or not, the first LiDAR survey was flown, the USGS again, was the Shoals group, and they, all the shallow part of the map that you see on the walls everywhere was a blue-green laser LiDAR data set. So they shot one color to penetrate the water, they get a return from that, they shoot another color to bounce off the water, and so they get both the water itself and the bottom. So that's why there's some very detailed maps up shallow in the old 1998, which is really 1998 plus 2000 Shoals data set. But again, we don't have the ability to take a backhoe here, right? So we have to use some of our chirp imaging to, again, look at ruptures. It's a lot easier for a variety of reasons to do it quality flake, but we can still see, if not the main fault, we can see some of these little secondary faults offsetting little layers, and you'll have to trust me on this one and show you afterwards. We also see landslides that aren't these big landslides, but these big kind of debris flow turbidites that are basically coming off these walls that are likely triggered by earthquakes. Again, this gives you the sense of how everything's dipping to the west, downdrop to the east. That's the half grommet aspect. But here's the big guy, and it starts to die here into the dollar point, all right? And then it'll step over into the state line North Tahoe Fault. Actually, this summer we found another splay out here that helps accommodate the movement from the West Tahoe to this little itty-bitty guy and then onto the state line. Why does that matter, other than I got to say itty-bitty? Is that if you have a couple of those steps, it might allow the ruptures to transfer from the West Tahoe onto the state line. I think it's probably unlikely, but having found that other fault splay out there, it gives us a little more opportunity to think about those scenarios. One of the things, at least to my eye, when you go out there and I've walked around all these things, is that when you get towards Dollar Point, end of it, obviously at some level these features look like, if they're fault scarps, have a lot more height, or perhaps they have these kind of curious little bits here. And this is looking upslope, you can barely tell it at this guy. This might be actual, this little splay curving out like that. There might be some stuff in here. It definitely has a different character than everything to the south. In other words, I'm not sure what's going on there, but if I had to bet, there's a lot less flip happening up into Agate Bay than there is on the south shore of the lake. That would be my guess. We were back onto the state line fault. This is just a picture from the screen looking at a couple splays of the state line fault. And by looking at this picture, as we know from last year, this was middle June. I mean, literally snowed on us the day before. I mean, is this crazy or what? Again, this is the fault that cruises up here. This one starts to die. This one starts to pick up steam. One of the interesting things we did back in 2004 is trench at the elementary school, as you all know here, that's no longer open. And that's, again, kind of conventionally what you like to do, is get your backhoe out, get dirty. You can, you know, and the thing that always blows me away about these faults, especially this trench, is that, you know, you end up having this rupture that starts 10 kilometers into the earth and it gets localized sometimes onto something the thickness of a butter knife. You know, all this death and destruction, and yet it's very localized. And here's another view back looking at the fault scarp. And this is what the fault looks like coming on shore. And again, we have about 20 centimeter resolution, so it doesn't quite look like this, but we can run around and cut a trench this size in about 4 or 5 seconds. So there's trade-off. And here's your beautiful, if you all live in Incline here, here's the fault scarp view of Incline Village. You can see the LiDAR data come shooting out. Isn't that beautiful? You can see all your streets. As I said, this is a bare earth, so they basically removed every house that you own. So this is what it would look like if you weren't here. Anyhow.
Highway running from left to right.
The what now?
Highway running from left to right. Sorry, the highway running from left to right.
Yeah, so this is 28.
Yeah.
And I believe this is Southwood here, ripping around. Okay. So, and here's the elementary school, here's the playground. Right, and then there used to be a place to cut your hair up here. I can't remember what else is in that. And you can even see at the kind of microscopic scale that there are all these little grooves and twos and fros. There's actually a couple houses here that are built across it. There's at least one split level house. I swear to God. This is split level. Again, it's best from our work. This is ruptured about 500 years ago. It is much less active than the other two faults in the basin, and I lived next to it for 2 years, so.
Can you show me where the high it is?
Let's look at the next one. I think I'm looking at a different perspective.
How far
up
the
mountains?
We'll get there. Absolutely. Right to the top. All right, so you know the high end is kind of down this area. If it makes you feel better, we can move it here. But it's roughly in this area. Okay, so here's it looking here. You can definitely see it in here. What's interesting is it loses some of its definition here. You pick up some other feature, and you know, if I had a couple more Sam Adams, I might think that this might be some antithetic fault to this. I don't know. We went and looked at it. It's like, well, it might just be cut from erosion. It comes up along here, and now it's going to truck out this way.
So that's north-south, going side to side.
I'm keeping you guys awake.
We're trying.
Isn't there Burt Cedar Creek that basically runs down the fault line?
Mm-hmm. You mean right by the fire department?
No, it starts right behind the old grade school, and I mean, now I think that was Shoreline Circle, right down
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
Would that make sense? I mean, would there be a creek there?
Well, certainly you can imagine if you have a piece of earth and it kind of tilts in this way, you're going to build in the space that streams will take advantage of. But not always. I mean that's the case. And there was one more.
Isn't it, I have almost heard that if the closer you are to that whole line, yeah. the less you feel that earthquake.
Well, that's because you die quickly.
You don't know what it is.
No, there are effects very within that zone of the fault. There are amplification effects. There are these kind of the equivalent of supersonic waves. So here's and you can they tried to say, hey, put something on the wall here that sounds smart or something. It took me for a long time. Earthquakes don't just, and we say the West Tahoe fault goes, it just doesn't go boom. It actually ruptures at the shear wave velocity, which is, take the P wave velocity divided by square root of 3, I know you're all writing these notes down. But it's a little more than half as slow. So what happens if you start propagating the earthquake at shear speeds, and then the earthquake in front of it decides, as it's being hit with the P wave, to start busting out on its own? So now it's going super shear. And in that zone where it's going super shear, you get some crazy ground motion. Even without super shear rupture, the game is, if I were in Tahoe, since they're all mostly normal fault, you always want to be on the side that doesn't drop down.
On the side of the drop down?
No, the side that doesn't drop down.
Okay,
because in some sense, that side isn't doing anything. The other side's really dropping down. The other thing is you want to be in the Bay Area at that time.
So from the west to the east faults, does the east side always fall?
Yes. It would appear that for the three main faults, they definitely all drop to the east. So they're always kind of making space. And so the deepest part of the lake is where you still are cutting in some of the down dropping from the Dog Point section of the West Tahoe Fault and some of the State Line Fault, and so it's accumulating two faults worth of drop down, and that's why the deepest part is there. everyone know about Incline Lake?
Yeah.
All right, so there's, you know, just to remind me that, you know, people are fighting over this and whatever. And
tell us a little about Incline Lake for those
of us who don't know. It's, for a while, I guess it was privately owned, and the U.S. Forest Service has taken it back. And then there's some amount of money that has to go back. And you can count how many dollars that is, depending on whether this is deemed as a safe structure or not. At any rate, as best we can tell, again, from the LiDAR, and we've walked it and been around it, it, you know, here's the fault start coming up here. So it doesn't appear to break through any of the abutments or through the dams themselves. And actually, this was just settled out of court a couple of days ago.
So the fault is just to the west of the lake?
Yeah. Just to the west. You know what's weird, though? So I literally, I was right in this area when the Washington, D.C. earthquake happened. And then somehow the Washington Post called me, and I was sitting on this fault scarp. You know, the weird thing about Tahoe is you think, like, okay, faults, and you make space, and things drop down, and the faults are in the deep part. But Tahoe's probably a relatively young basin, and so you have some of these faults towards the north and south end cruising up well above 8,000 feet. When the lower parts are, you know, down in the water, down at the, whatever, 50 or 6,000 minus another 15, you know, they're down almost at the level of Gardnerville and Memphis. So this has application to help kind of people resolve about whether faults are good, cut through dam.
So I have a question. So how does the fault here connect down to Incline? You mentioned the fire ducts.
Yeah, point. So it's kind of, and I apologize. I apologize again. So, all right, so here we go. Comes in here, all right, and then it connects back this way and around this large kind of mountain abutment, okay, and then it swings in over by Incline Lake.
We can see 431 on that back there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it basically comes down here, comes in here, and it kind of gets a little less kind of organized. And then it wraps back around, and I just showed you. All right, and then again, there's 431. And you could follow this up another maybe mile or so before it's, at least in the LiDAR, I'm sure one might be able to follow it further. Who likes skiing at Homewood? So it's kind of an interesting place. If I have it right, I think this is oil phase. And but you know, maybe everyone else has already seen this, but when you look at the LiDAR and you just see all these kind of failures, yeah. And I found that to be kind of, and there, obviously there's something going on here along this part here, but if you notice these failures up here.
When you say failures, is that
landslides? Landslides. Some of them are beautifully expressed in this data. Even if you don't care about landslides, they just look beautiful and they kind of add to the double diamond.
Almost like fingerprints pushed down there.
Yeah. If we head a little bit south towards Rubicon, if I can push the buttons right. This is something that I've been trying to, like, been looking at for a while. So the Emerald Bay is kind of cutting out this way. Here's the big steep Rubicon drop off. And the question is, obviously, most of the fault movement's coming down here. Anything bleeding out into this area, and you do get some hints of these scarps here. But it was just the other day looking at it, I mean, it really looks like this guy here is just a landslide failure. So this scarp has a better chance, in my opinion, of being due to a head scarp from this landslide here than actually having a fault come across there. So, you can just go around now. Steve McQuinn has been sending me all the landslides, and he thinks that Sand Harbor might be kind of a landslide off of that kind of where the help me that flume trail. Thank you. Down that phase, and it could very well could be. I mean, I don't see the failure. I don't see the part that slid, but it wouldn't surprise me either.
You don't have a picture of that. Okay.
Heather's always like, keep it under 2 hours. All right, so what's next? So we get the big features with airborne LiDAR, so we're flying in an airplane, or someone's flying in the airplane, and they got the inertial guidance system, and they get these beautiful maps. But what if we want to get the ground basically at centimeter scale? All right. And as we see, we put this in here because it's for us, the release of the Blu-ray Star Wars version. It might really look like this. And this is this eyesight scanner we've been using, terrestrial LiDAR system, for about 7 years. Mostly down looking at cliff erosion in La Jolla and other parts in Southern California, but we also have been going out to Mecca Hills on the southern San Andreas Fault. And it just looks cool. These are all the different scans of different colors. We're basically set this sucker up and let it spin on its axis, and we get a cloud of points, and we see the ground, we see all the bushes, we see the beer cans, and so we have to do our own bare earth editing. And you might get something like this. And so here's Mecca Hills. And for a seismologist, it's Mecca. And the Sonar San Andreas just cut through right here. And so what we want to do is look at how all the little stream channels are kicked. So this part to the west is moving north relative to the part that is moving south. And if you look at the resolution of airborne LiDAR, it's called the B4 data set. On the San Andreas, can you imagine what B4 stands for? Before the big one. So here's the deal. If anyone shoots a data set and you want to buy property and they call it B4, it's never a good sign. But again, it highlights, as great as the airborne LiDAR looks, terrestrial would be better. And so, in the end, you take a leap of faith. What we can do is see offsets in stream channels that are, these are a meter or so, or several meters. And these are how many we see, and we see them at different times. You wouldn't be able to see that with airborne LiDAR. The reason why it's important is, what we want to do is go back and understand how big the latest offset on the San Andreas is. We have other means of determining when it was, but then how big's the rupture? And so the short of the long is that we basically, we can see that we can actually see the creep on the fault. This is the creep rate. And we can actually see the last earthquake and how much it slipped. And given the amount of time that's occurred since the last slip, how much it would slip today, it was 3.75, and 5.3 to 7 is, it's a lot bigger number. So if all the strain has built up, and there's no guarantee of that, but it's going to be a lot bigger earthquake than the last one. So what we'd like to do in Tahoe is start looking at whether these normal faults also have a little strike slip component. Look at when they cross a moraine. The moraine should have a certain amount of structure to it, or just any other feature that you see out there that looks like that fault's behaving a little bit peculiar. And we have about a half a dozen sites that we'll go out next summer. And the reason that's important is, so if it slips 4 meters this way, that's a certain size earthquake. If it slips 4 this way and 1 this way, it's really like whatever, 4 squared plus 1 squared square root. So it's a bigger event. So the geodetic GPS data suggests there's a lot of dextral slip in the basin that we don't see on these normal faults using the techniques that we use. So can we tease that out, or are those faults somewhere else? And it gets back again to how big of an earthquake can we have.
Is that strike slip component, is that consistent in that Walker Lane complex? Or
the dextral would be, so they, what they see, here's what they do. GPS is kind of interesting because you get to see how all these points are moving apart, but it's integrating, it has a huge footprint. So if you think you know the normal component, so if you just take a leap of faith and say, I'm going to break it up and believe these guys about how much vertical motion there is, then you can solve for the strike slip motion. Now, if we're wrong, then that next thing's incorrect. But there's clearly some of this going on in the basin. So, now that I've bumped you all out,
can you define dextral?
We call right lateral, or imagine you're looking at Lake Tahoe. So this is normal, down. This with this side moving up to the left, as opposed to the other direction.
Okay.
sensible. What you would predict from that microplate is that you should see about, I don't know, this 20-25% across the whole thing of normal and then 75% terrestrial. But it behaves in very mysterious ways, and it doesn't just always do that on every fault. It partitions out in different ways, and so that's what we have to do. All right, so to the shakeout part. So what can you do about it? So let us worry and argue about all these fault things. No matter what we tell you and no matter how we argue, the reality is there is a large component of earthquake hazard in your backyard. For some of you, it's in your backyard. And there's greater challenges than that for the state of Nevada, for example. So I cut this out, and these are 20th century earthquakes, 6.5 magnitude. I get to pick the breakout point to make a point, but that's a fair point because that's starting to get pretty big. And we can go through the list, and it's been a rather busy early part of the century on Pleasant Valley. Some people have this a lot bigger, but at any rate, it's certainly magnitude 7 to 15. Then we have Cedar Mountain out by Gap. It's about 1932. Excelsior Mountain, 34. Then we go in this crazy period over by Fallon, Stillwater. In 54, we get a 6.6 and 6.8. Then we get this 1-2 punch from Fairview Peak and Dixie Valley. Here's what your house would look like if you're on the hanging wall as part of the drops down. Right? So. Very famous picture, and this is what these fault scarves look like. And again, this is what the water would do in Tahoe if it all had to drop that much.
Is that scarf from just a single quake?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh no, we go to Hefgen Lake and show you one that's twice the size. We go to China and show you one that's 30 feet in a different environment. Hmm. 30 feet vertical. So that's not what I'm worried about, because we already know we can have magnitude 7s and lots of 6s and bunches of 5s and tons of 4s and too many 3s. The problem is, we're in a state where we haven't had to deal with really a large earthquake, save perhaps one little bitty corner at Wells, for a long time. We had Wells, we had the Devil Springs over by Gardnerville, about the same size, a little less than 6. We haven't had a real big one in a long time. And so how did your emergency management systems deal with it? Everybody who dealt with this when the state was 1/13th of the population are either dead or they're retired, living in Florida or something. So they're not around anymore. And yet we have to be able to be on our game the first time. We don't get a second crack at this. So that's a bummer, actually. That's not an easy thing to deal with. California, you worry about what? The big one, the 8s. But you get the 7s, right? You get to practice on the 7s. The Northridge, which is almost a 7, and then the World Series earthquake, almost a 7. And then some of them further out, like Landers out in the middle of nowhere, and kept your mind, but you still get to deal, the apparatus gets to deal with it. And so one of the things that because I can't figure out how to get people to kind of zone in on this. So let's say I learned to play basketball with a bunch of kids in preparation for playing LeBron James. Right, okay? I mean, it's just not gonna work. He's gonna just slam it right by me and I'm gonna, yeah. So we wanna find a way of kind of getting prepared as a state. So one of the things that excited me about when I came up here a few years ago was a program that was already initiated in California called the Great California Shakeout. And this was first done 4 years ago, and it was to this model earthquake where you ruptured from Bombay Beach, from the bar at Bombay Beach at the Salton Sea, up past Wrightwood in the ski area. And that's the magnitude like 7.8. And they wanted to use that as the scenario rupture to get people to get prepared. And that means not only governments and businesses, but also families, schools. School's the most important thing. And so Mark Benthian at USC, got this thing started. And last year we were the first state in the United States to join California. So we got in second. Now it's moved to the Midwest. Utah's coming in next year. Oregon's came in last year, but during their 300th anniversary for the tsunami. British Columbia, Guam, even Myanmar, Burma, has asked to join. Countries from all over the world, including, you know. So I was like, Mark, do you have to get rid of all the political prisoners first before you work with them? So what are we going to do, North Korea next? So we want to go to shakeout.org/Nevada, or just go to www.shakeout.org, and then click Nevada. And we'd love you to sign up. That was the admission price that you didn't know about. Just look at the back of your ticket, and then tell your friend. And what we want people... If you're on the California, we want you to register California.
Gotcha.
If you're on the Nevada, Nevada. The state franchise tax board, check it.
What are we registering for? What are we...
So here's what we're going to do. Okay. So on October 20th, it's the third Thursday of the year, October 20th at 10:20. So this year was 10:20, 10:20. Last year was 10:21, 10:21 in the morning. Next year is the 18th of October at 10:18 in the morning. So we get the drill. So 10:20 in the morning, we want you to do the drop, cover, and hold on drill. We don't want you to make it more complicated than that. If you leave your work baits or just at home, and what that means is to essentially drop, if there's a desk nearby, get under it. If not, lower your cross-section. So I should also say that Annie and Ruben were in the back there. We're in the 7.1 in Christchurch. You're not running for the door jam, right?
No, you can't.
You can't.
You physically cannot move. You can't walk.
Here's the deal.
If you did, there's broken glass all over the floor. So if it's the middle of the night, you'll injure yourself further. So it's wherever you are. You physically cannot walk across the floor.
So when you're playing with the big boys, you can't. So when you're in Mogul or little earthquakes, I think on fours in Southern California, it's like, oh, everyone, let's run to the same door jam. And it's kind of scary and fun at the same time. When you start getting in the high sixes and sevens, you literally fall down and potentially break your arm or whatever. So it's either get underneath something and hold on, because you don't want the desk to move away, or you're just going to essentially drop down your cross section.
Like this, and project it back through.
Okay. What we don't want you to do, what we really don't want you to do, is go, wow, I saw Ian Buckle at the shake table the other day, and now I'm a structural engineer. So there's something called the triangle of life. So I know exactly how this building's going to fail. So now I'm not going to go where I normally go. I'm going to go right next to it and find that void space. So you'll see out there the triangle of life people. This one guy, actually. And he's brutal when he writes you and tells you that you're a baby killer, literally, last year. That you should be telling kids not to get under the desk. You go right next to them because the desk collapsed. And then there's a space next to the desk. Well, what he doesn't say is then the beam can go the other way. So it is the engineers, the UN, the Red Cross, the Red Crescent have all agreed. It's all written now after this guy went kind of postal last year, that in kind of Western building structures, which would be the US, Europe, Japan, you want to do the drop cover limit. If you're in BAM, Iran, and you're in an adobe house, you run. Because you'll just be crushed. So that's the lesson there. And that's very easy. Just go on there and you click and you sign up. And you can look. If you say you want your name to be up there, that's great. And then you can look at all your other friends that haven't signed up and then get a little case. Now here's what the drill is if we were going to play
this
in the classroom.
This is the great shakeout. You're joining billions of Californians and Nevadans in the largest earthquake drill in U.S. history. Practice now so you can protect yourself during a real earthquake. This is an earthquake drill. Right now, drop, cover, and hold on. Unless you're driving, drop to the ground now. If you're standing under a large earthquake, the ground might jerk strongly and throw you down. Take cover under something sturdy to protect yourself from objects being hurled across the room. Hold on to it until the shaking stops. If you can't get under something, stay low and protect your head and neck with your arms. Now, look around. What objects might fall or be thrown at you in an earthquake that you should secure in place now? Finally, strong earthquakes may trigger tsunami-type waves in lakes. If you're near the beach at Lake Tahoe during an earthquake, drop, cover, and hold on. Then walk quickly to high ground when the shaking stops. This drill is over. Visit shakeout.org/Nevada for simple steps to help you survive and recover from a major earthquake, including how to secure your space. Thank you for taking part in the Great Nevada Shakeout.
Great. So, this is what we help you do. And so, by the only other way of saying it is that if you don't do this, or even if you do, just realize that if you have most of the citizens in Nevada in your area who don't do this drill, they're going to be in line in front of you at the emergency room. So we have to realize that one of the ways that we can protect all of us, it's like, I know it's a bad analogy, but it's like a vaccine. If we can all do it to some degree, we can reduce the exposure to everybody else. And so we're really trying to get Nevadans. The governor today has a proclamation with a bunch of whereas, but it says, whereas you should do the shakeup. And so we've got him on board, and we really want people to take it seriously. Now, kind of what we hope is that we do most attention at schools and universities and whatnot, is that the kids come home and go, Mom, Dad, where's our family plan? Who has a family planner? Oh my God, you guys are killing me. All right. Family plan, where are you guys going to meet? If your neighborhood is no longer there, if your house could be perfect and there could be a gas leak, where are you going to meet? You can't be the next door neighbor's house, right? That doesn't work, right? Do you have food? Just the other day, I took a big picture above my bed frame, and I said, you know what? I've been telling everyone to take this down. It's down, because it will fall on me. So if you have like this really big mirror sitting above your bed, just realize a third or a fourth of your life's in your bed. That will probably come down on you 25-33% of the time. So we want people to go through. I know everyone's starting to get all depressed. There's on the website, there's seven steps to earthquake safety. And you want to secure your area? Go through your house tonight. Are all your wall units connected? Right? Mm-hmm. Let's start kind of get the economy going back. Hire a contractor to get those walls or those things braced. Make your family plan. Have a disaster kit. You should probably need it for the weather here anyhow, the way it's been going lately. Again, is your place safe in a larger sense? I mean, in Reno, there are a lot of unreinforced masonry buildings, and those are likely to collapse. So can you start mitigating that problem? Practice a drop, cover, and hold on, right, Annie? Because when you're in the middle of a 7.1, I was in a 7.2 the same year, go figure. You don't have time to go, well, oh, what am I supposed to do? You need to be able to do it just like throwing a football, like the Chargers quarterback should learn. He's actually pretty good, it's arrested me. Now, it's kind of a bummer night, at least for me, because I'm a big Apple fan. It's good for me now to say that, you know, after 12 years of being beat up by my PC friend, that they're the largest company in the world. And so one thing that he learned, and now I have Unix on my laptop, and this laptop is as powerful as my million dollar SGI about 10 years ago. I can bring it out in the field, and all this stuff works. But the reason why, in my opinion, the reason why they're the number one company, tech company in the world, is it's think different. And that applies to studying. And one of the things that has been enjoyable for me is to also be on the cutting edge of building new equipment so that we can visualize measurement and we don't have to follow another people's plans. So we have, NSF's given us $1.8 million and we've developed this new chirp profiler that will go much deeper and we'll be able to look back further in time and wherever we go, and we'll bring it up here next summer, and that's going to give us a kind of telescope back in time. And I think a lot of us who have already drank Kool-Aid, I admit it, but that's exactly how we do better science, is to do things differently. If you're doing what your advisor's doing, you fail. If you're doing what you did 10 years ago, you fail. And there's just the whole world's out there, and it's exciting right now to go out and do science. So it's kind of a barb night for me, at least, but we can take a lesson from there.
When did this happen? What?
Today.
Like
today.
5 o'clock today.
Yeah. So anyway, that's a Tahoe I love. That's very tranquil, but you know, every once in a while it's going to not do that, and we got to be prepared.
Pretty picture.
So we got first.
Can you tell us about that Carson fault, Carson City?
Yeah. So we have the Genoa fault, and it's another monster. It potentially could be the largest normal fault really in the Walker Lane, maybe in the Basin Range. it's ruptured twice the last 2,000 years, including about the same time as the Incline Village Fault. So the Incline Village Fault very well could have been triggered by the Genoa Fault. Okay? And when you're down by the golf course in Genoa and you're heading to the south, a little bit towards Marketville and heading up towards Carson, there's that just uninterrupted scarp. And you can actually, across from Wally Hot Springs, you could see where the there was a quarry and they basically unearthed the scarp and you could walk up to the fault.
I'm touching the fault.
But you basically have the West Tahoe Fault and the Genoa Fault, and at least what is very interesting to me in the study in the future is how dependent are those two systems? In other words, if I could look through time, is there a clustering of earthquakes on the Genoa and then on the West Tahoe and back and forth? Is it like sum out, or are they just totally unrelated? And what we do know is the further we go back in time on the Genoa, the lower the slip rates become. And so clearly it's had some action lately. During that time, we know the West Tahoe hasn't went. So that's not too many data points to start arm waving, but I'm arm waving nonetheless. Going into Carson City, it's a structurally difficult situation. And then you start regaining kind of a scarp that might, or a fault that might be able to rupture by a washaway. And then you kind of go by steamboat, and then there's the faults that cross the Mount Rose Fan. So one of the questions is, how far can you rupture through Carson City? Or are those two segments going to be apart? A situation where it's a lot like Incline. It's much more active, but it's certainly early in its earthquake cycle, but that doesn't mean anything if it ruptures tomorrow. But these two fault systems are very curious, and I'd like to know over time how much they jive with each other. And then in Lake Tahoe, I'd like to know if you can basically rupture across the West Tahoe onto the state line on the Incline. That's the black swan. Maybe it only happens once every 50,000 years, but you don't want to be, because then you could start building out larger magnitude.
We hikers on the Tahoe River Trail a lot.
Yeah.
And I looked for an extension of the state line fault on the right, and I haven't really seen anything up that high. Is there something visible up there?
You know, and I might not be the best person to ask. Rich back here, and he's maybe walked it more. It seems to me that most of the load of the state line fault, by the time you get to those townhomes or whatever you call it, it's starting to die off pretty rapidly. And then obviously things are picking up over onto the Incline Village Fault. And I've looked at that a whole bunch with the LiDAR, and I don't see anything that makes me go, wow, there it is. So again, it's like it's one fault system with three or four splays, depending on how you look at our segments. And then obviously they die at the ends. So okay,
but you said maybe it jumps over to the Incline fault at that point. You mentioned where it is at Incline Lake. Yeah. I was there last week, so I can visualize what you're saying.
I mean, at some level, that's the basic thing, and the details are being worked out or need to be worked out. But again, at the level of what most people are interested in, right, we're in a lake where basins where there's a lot of earthquake potential.
So
here and there.
All the LiDAR data and the previous mapping that was done, that just shows these surface expressions of these faults. Is there anything going on that shows on what's happening at depth?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, again, we're having fun here. Obviously, the lab that I run has been doing essentially through the Nevada Seismic Network, which is also in Eastern California, Arizona. We've been looking at microseismicity and some kind of bigger seismicity through this region. And these faults, the big faults like West Tahoe and Genoa, are interesting because they tend to not have a lot of seismicity, as does or does not the Wasatch Fault. So a lot of faults will sit there and give their dip and their shape or convey it via smaller earthquakes. But some of the very big earthquakes or big fault lines that are normal don't do that. So
there's not really a 3D picture of what's going on in the Tahoe Basin necessarily. We're just kind of skimming the surface.
Here's the problem with seismicity. And we learned from the Salton Sea, because everyone looked at 40 years of seismicity in the Salton Sea and missed these big normal faults just because they hadn't had an earthquake on it. and they weren't lining up with these little baby earthquakes. And so if you were to take a seismicity map of the Reno Tahoe Carson area and essentially say that's the only way that I can determine whether I should buy a house or not, you would, and pretend the water's not there, you would pretty much build on the Genoa Fault and the West Tahoe Fault because of the lack of seismicity. Now, look at that map 20 years after the next big rupture. You'd be like, I'm out of there. I'm not building anywhere near. So seismicity maps are kind of confusing because of characteristics like big normal faults that tend to not have it, when was the last event, so on and so forth, and how long have I been measuring seismicity. So I think, again, what we would say is that it's the whole evidence. It's the shoe leather on the ground. In a couple places like that, it's getting wet in the lake. It's flying above with an airplane with LiDAR. It's doing everything you can, looking at seismicity, looking at the GPS, look at the big broad picture, how things are being pulled apart. And in sum total, I think together we're all kind of getting a better picture of what this system is. There's still a lot of questions. My biggest question is, what the heck did that McKinney Bay slide out on? Is it a stratigraphic horizon? Is it a basement contact? Does it cross-cut stratigraphy? Now go image those platforms where there's still dirt above it. Can you image it? Is that something that has the potential of sliding up in some manner similar to the McKinney Bay? So that, to me, is a very interesting question. Gotta keep fruit on the tree, right?
Well, in the first slide, you were showing that you were able to track some little small curve that happened, what, last week or week before. Is some website we can go to account?
So yeah, just go to NetQuakes. It's a USGS website. Just type NetQuakes in the Google, and then you'll see NetQuakes, and then it'll break it down. You'll see data. You click there, and then it'll show you the whole world. And on the left-hand side, there'll be a list, and you just click Nevada. And then you'll see that picture, and you'll see hopefully more and more green crosses. And then the instrument you want, click it, and it'll show you the last earthquake. And then you click something else beneath it, and it'll show you all the earthquakes recorded for a certain period of time. So, for example, the next time you all feel an earthquake here in Incline, just go over to the NetQuake site, and you click, and you get to see the ground motion. What we get to do is get a better sense of what that earthquake was or is. Also here. Any other questions? Go ahead.
You mentioned the net quakes. A couple of years ago, two or three years ago, just before Christmas, there was a quake that was easily felt in this region here. Didn't show up in USGS website for 24 hours.
Okay.
And I always wondered why, because I thought that stuff was all automated.
Yes.
Yet that evening, nothing showed up in USGS.
It was it a guy fire? No, I know.
It would be not last Christmas,
but the other Christmas.
Yeah.
Because my family was up here, and my daughter felt it. And it was kind of like, I didn't feel that. Because I have this kind of Southern California filter. It's not over about 4.5, somehow I don't feel it.
Yeah, my kids are upset because it wasn't a big quake, but it was easily felt. But it didn't show up when you went to the USGS.
Okay, so just as a point of fact, so here's how it works. And this is a whole other talk, but I'll. So we run a network, and we're co-funded from the state and of Nevada and from the USGS. And so we have to report earthquakes of a certain size out by a certain period of time, right? If it's a magnitude 1, and it happens to be a misfire, no one's sweating the bullet, okay? Once they hit magnitude 3, everything has to be reviewed by seismologists. Okay? That thing doesn't get out unless we click review, right? So the one that I know of, I know that at least on our site, it was up right away because my daughter felt it. The USGS then grabs our data through this EIDS system and then essentially posts it, right? Now, if we smoke our system in a big earthquake, what they're going to do is, if we're dead in the water, they're going to use all the outside seismometers to essentially do the best job they can. But again, realize that if we have a magnitude 7 in Minden, it might be the West Tahoe fault, and we won't know the difference. We don't have that accuracy of location if we're locating from Sacramento and Salt Lake. That's why we have to keep our system up and running. But there are, and I'll get the answer, there are these ways of passing information, and we try to have a fail-safe system, but, you know, but again, if you go to our Seismo website, you know, you should see everything, and if it's more than a 3, you know that somebody went, okay. Less than a 3, we go back.
Before it gets posted, you're saying, you're saying in your site, it's posted right where the USGS may have taken longer.
But they should have, that should have pumped up.
Yeah, it didn't. I don't know why, it was weird.
I think I remember something about that. Actually, there was like a big ice storm, and the antennas weren't working.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, those could be a situation if we don't locate something. I mean, here's the scary thing, this last winter. We have the toughest environment, at least in the 48 states, for running our communications when we get 72 feet at Alpine Meadows. And yet, we shoot all of our data from the high mountain peaks. And guess what gets hit first? The good news, and this is a different talk, is that we've gotten money to redo the Tahoe trucking network. So it's all going to go digital. Which means we have better seismometers, we'll have more paths, we'll probably try to tunnel things into Turk, for example, as a backup, just trying to get on the internet any way we can. We usually shoot internet through the air, okay? And so as we build this system out, we're gonna try to build a more fail-safe system. The system we have up here is, what's that word, rickety. But again, if it fails, I mean, if our big scary thing is a huge earthquake during one of these gigantic storms that takes down our network. So anyway.
Oh, that was my comment. I was going to say I remember when that happened. So.
All right.
All right. So I'm going to stand up and let's give Graham a round of applause.